there. Welcome to today's session. We are going to study today a work titled Selections from Cry of a Girl, written by Emmanuel Labrette. So this work falls under the category disability narratives. So what exactly is a disability narrative? Disability narrative or disability studies, they are stories told by the persons who are disabled. So this consists of their life, their experiences, their real life situations, the anxieties, the trauma, their feelings, all these confronted by the persons who are disabled. And through this, they actually try to or strive to highlight their disabled identity. And this disabled narrative also comprises of works written by other persons, okay, on behalf of the persons who are disabled. But anyway, the work that we are going to study today is an authentic work written by a real life person who is physically challenged. So as I told you earlier, the work is written by Emmanuel Labrette, and she was hearing impaired by birth. And she was born in Paris on 18 October 1971. So as I told you, she was hearing impaired by birth. Still, she became a French actress. You know what? After schooling, she took to acting. And she was the first hearing impaired French actress to win the Molière Award in the category Best New Talent. So, you know, when matters come to the representation of the physically challenged, so we have seen that there is a clear case of othering or discrimination, and it is prevalent. It can be seen everywhere. Okay, it doesn't matter whether it is a developing country or a developed country. It is always there. Leonard J. Davis, in his introduction to the second edition of Disability Studies, he remarks, "For centuries, people with disabilities have been an oppressed and repressed group. They're isolated, they're controlled, instructed and regulated to a degree probably unequal to that is experienced by any minority group." But anyway, the text that we are going to study today, it highlights some other idea. Okay? From the receiving and requesting end, these persons who are disabled, they're trying for a declaring, assertive and self-defining perspective. So it's a struggle for them. Okay, it's a struggle for survival for them. We know that disability was considered as a limitation or a very serious social ignominy. Ignominy means a disgrace or a public shame. Okay, in the earlier times. But nowadays we know the times have changed, and we actually have started to include them as a part of human diversity and humanity. Anyway, the narrative opens up many issues. Okay, the struggle of the disabled to survive, parental attitude, which is really, really important in such cases, need for the right training, okay, at appropriate time in their life, then and varying social attitudes. So all these are actually dealt with in the text. So let's literally move on to the text as such. I told you the text is titled as Selections from the Cry of the Girl. The Cry of the Girl is basically an autobiography written by Labrette, and we are just going to study a portion taken out of it. Okay, is that clear? I hope so. Well, so the lesson actually starts like this. She says that, "I used to cry aloud. I used to scream aloud. There was one reason." She says, "It was not because I was hungry, I was thirsty, I had some pain, or out of anger that I cried or screamed aloud. There was a reason. I was beginning to want to talk. Okay, so right now you have to stand in the shoes of a deaf person or a hearing impaired person and start thinking. Well, and she goes on to the extent of saying that maybe because I used to make such a kinds of shrieking noise or voices, my parents nicknamed me with a French word, mute. Okay, mute literally means seagull in French. So she says that maybe because the seagull also makes such kinds of shrieking sound that nobody can understand, right? So that may be one reason they gave me such a name. Then she literally goes on talking about how her mother felt about her newborn child, okay, about Emmanuel Labret from the time of her birth. Mother says that she was a very beautiful child from the time of the birth, and she was so cute and she had appropriate weight and everything. You know what, she also adds one more idea into it, okay? She remembers it very well. See, even though they are playing loud music in one room, and when the baby is actually lying in another room, she will sleep peacefully. And parents literally took that case as a matter like, child is such a well-behaved one. Okay, that was their first way of taking her reaction and responses to the world when she was just a newborn baby. She was well-behaved. Well, but when the time passed, she literally reached a state in which she should crowd like other babies and should start literally calling her parents mama and dada. She was never ever responding like that. No such growth was, or signs of growth was literally there with her. So her parents, they went on, okay, like that. They never had any confusion about whether this baby is born with some disability or not. There is no way for that too. Both of them are normal persons, and no other person in their family also had any kind of such disabilities too. Well, it was Uncle Fifo is actually her father's older brother. It was Uncle Fifo who told the family, who informed the family that the reason why Emmanuel Labret is crying, why she is crying, is just because she just can't hear herself. That shocked the family for the first time. They took her to a pediatrician. He was never ever ready to get convinced that she had some kind of hearing impairment problem. Okay, hearing impairments. But anyway, the parents approached the same pediatrician again and again, and one day, to go to its extreme, this doctor literally told Labret's mother, you should get some counseling. Okay, can't you see that the girl is literally responding to many things? You know why and how she is responding? Although she was born hearing impaired, she could sense the vibrations. So if you are slamming the door, she could literally respond to that just because she could understand the vibrations. Okay. And this confused the doctor as well as the parents too. So they too got into some kind of a confusion because they couldn't fix the problem. You know what? Her parents retried all means, okay, in order to check whether she could literally listen to the sound in this way or the other. But many a times she would react, but some other times she will never ever even respond like she had heard that noise. So normally they felt a kind of a confusion. When she was 9 months old, she was taken into a specialist. Okay, so the specialist he certified that she was born profoundly deaf. But being the parents of such a beautiful child, okay, they were never ever ready to believe that. Okay, and what they did was, they went to a hospital, Trozo Hospital, and they went to consult another specialist. and he made her listen to some loud sounds, okay, and which could literally pierce anybody's eardrum. But what was the reaction of the child? She was totally unresponsive, and the parents literally realized that she's deaf. She is deaf. Well, the mother just asked three questions to the doctor. The first question is, will she talk? And the doctor said, yes, but it will take a long time. The second question was, what should we do? And the doctor said, provide a hearing aid, get her into speech therapy. The third question was like this, is there any way to meet some deaf adults? And the doctor replied, that wouldn't be a good idea. They belong to a generation that didn't have early training, and you would be totally disappointed and discouraged. So when they confronted this thing, the parents literally got shocked. Okay, and it is something, you know, something that will happen with any parents if they come to realize that their child is hearing impaired or deaf by birth. And you know, when they realize the fact, like, they have to literally, you know, she is going to struggle in the world, okay, in the normal world, they got shocked. And moreover, they were feeling guilty about themselves. Okay, they started literally feeling themselves as faulty, and she cried. Okay, her mother cried, and she started thinking, was it genetic? Okay, if at all there is problem with there, was it because of some illness that I got during my pregnancy? So they started literally thinking over the subject matter over and over again. Well, Labyrinth's memories about her child was blank. It was said that it's just chaos in my head, a series of completely unrelated images. She says that the memories about my childhood, it was like film sequences edited together with long strips of blank film, giant lost spaces. So this is how she recounts her memories about her childhood. She says that up to the age of 7, she only had visual memories. You just imagine her situation. Past, future, everything was actually on the same time-space line. Okay? And she couldn't differentiate what is here. You know, she says that I used to hear my mother talking about yesterday and tomorrow, but I couldn't ever literally differentiate between them, okay, until the age of 7. For me, everything was visual. Okay, she says, I just can't even assign dates to things during the period from my birth to 7 years of age. And I couldn't even tell that how old I was. Okay, she found only fragments about her childhood, fragments of images. But anyway, she says, I still managed everything. Well, you know what? On reaching a particular stage, the family, parents literally appointed a therapist in their home. So from there, she learned how to communicate with the help of the therapist. And she followed Borel-Maisony method. But anyway, you know, it was fine from the part of the mother, in the sense like she could understand that, you know, she will be able to talk to her daughter better. Because when doctor declared that she is born deaf, she is not going to talk, or it will take a longer time, she was shocked, and she had literally felt a kind of a disconnection with her daughter. But with the help of the therapist, mother felt like I could, you know, it was literally giving hope to her. And she started imitating how therapists used to communicate with her. And the mother and the daughter actually started to literally build a kind of a bond between them. She says that it might be because of our umbilical connection that we got to know each other, you know, fast. And there were literally attempts from the part of, okay, many trials from the part of the mother. She had adjusted that much, okay, she had dedicated her life that much for the well-being of her child. And because of that, they literally, although they made use of the sign language, the language of gestures and everything, you know, they were in a position to communicate with each other. Okay, what happened to her father then? So the relation between, the bond between Labrut and her mother grew day after day. But father, you know, a person who has to go out to work, when he returns in the evening, he too wanted to talk to her baby. And over and above, Labrut was eagerly waiting to talk to her father too. She wanted to know about him more and more. But the trouble was, he never got an opportunity to be with the therapist. He couldn't literally go through the training sessions as mother had gone through. So he couldn't literally go for a bonding with, or even get into a communication with Labrut. So that was the trouble. And Labrut says that, and because of that, the father was left out. Okay, he was not spending too much time with Labrut, so he couldn't understand her well. That's the thing, and he felt excluded. She says that she wanted to talk to her father, know more about him. Okay, how sentimental she is. Okay, these ideas, you get all these kinds of emotions and feelings only if you write authentic, or only if you read or get to know authentic literature. And this is one among them. Well, she concludes this particular work by this idea that, as any deaf child, a hearing aid was planted inside my ear, which actually channeled noises into my ear, into my brain basically. But she says that, but I couldn't differentiate between the noises that got into my brain just because they were all the same. And he says, so it was that implantation, okay, that was more tiring than anything else. She says she doesn't know how many times this hearing aid fell into her soup. Still, she wore it as, you know, ordered by the therapist over there. Well, and she ends up this portion, this excerpt, with this note, with this comment made by her mother. Her mother says the family would find consolation in trite. Trite means silly statements. She may be deaf, but she is so cute. She will just be that much smarter. Okay, so these are some, you know, common statements of consolation that this, the family will end up with. And that literally proved to be true in her case, because although she was hearing impaired, from the age of 7, she says that with the help of the therapist, she was able to communicate, okay, learn. She learned alphabets, okay, using this hands and gesture method and all. And she was able to comprehend, okay, what is happening around her. She could fix what is tomorrow, what is yesterday and everything. She started getting a chronological order of the time, which was something that never ever happened with her before she was 7 years. Okay. And she fixed that she could also be, okay, a successful person in her life. And she literally followed her intuitions to become an actor. We know she had become a famous French actor. So her story is really motivating and inspiring to one and all, especially those who are differently abled. Okay, they are also one among them. Okay, so I hope we have literally discussed all the main portion of the short story. It's a very simple story. So you go through the text, and if you have any doubts, you can WhatsApp me at any time. Okay, thank you everyone. Thank you.